Hi everybody, my name is Kai Wehner. Welcome to my talk today, Systems Integration in the NoSQL Era with Apache Camel. Before I start with my talk, I want to introduce myself shortly. I work for Talend, that's an open source company which offers products like an ESB, BPM, data integration, big data components, and all of that combined in one integration suite. And I do a lot of that stuff for different customers, and one of these parts is NoSQL, which is much more important in the meantime. And so I think this is a great talk to show the Apache Camel features of this. If you have any questions after the conference, you can write me an email or contact me via social networks, via Xing or LinkedIn, or write me a Twitter message, so I'm happy and glad for every feedback. Okay, so why I'm doing this talk today? The most important part is that the number of applications and interfaces grows in every company, no matter where you work. You have to use new technologies and new products everywhere, and nevertheless, these products have to be combined together. One application has to work with another application, right? So they have to communicate with each other. And additionally, there's a new paradigm. There's NoSQL, which probably started some years ago. But in the meantime, most companies have to use one or other NoSQL database. And you have to use them, you have to integrate them. And sometimes when I see customers, they write a lot of glue code to integrating all of these NoSQL components. So, of course, in the end, all roads lead to Rome, so you can write a lot of glue code every time when you do these integrations. But the system integrator usually has some other wishes. He wants to use standardized modeling for doing these integrations. He wants to realize it efficiently. And finally, he also wants to test it automatically. So that's the wishes for systems integrators, for integration generally, and also for integration of NoSQL databases, of course. And that's the reason why I want to do this talk today. And here I'm really talking about systems integration in the NoSQL era with Apache Camel. And so let's look at the key messages of the talk. What I'm going to show you today is the first thing is NoSQL, in my opinion, cannot be avoided. In almost every company I see, there are use cases where you have to use one or another NoSQL database for some use cases. Of course, they do not replace SQL databases, but for some use cases, you have to use them. And the good news is NoSQL integration is already possible. And the very good news is Apache Camel helps a lot, as you will see in the talk today. And so let's look at the agenda first. First, I will talk very shortly about NoSQL so that we have all the same definition of NoSQL. And then I will give an introduction to Apache Camel. By the way, who of you already knows Apache Camel? Okay, that's a few of them. So I will give a short introduction to Camel so that everybody knows what I'm talking about. And then I will show several different examples how you can integrate these different NoSQL concepts. And the great thing about Camel is that you can integrate all of these different NoSQL concepts with the same style, as you will see later when I show you how to integrate all of these different databases. I will also show some live demos with different tooling, which supports you when you have to integrate it. Okay, so let's first start with an introduction to SQL. It's just two slides. And the first slide is really a very good one from the 451 group, a research group. It perfectly shows all the different products which are available at the moment. And the main difference is here that you can see on the right side the relational databases, the SQL databases. And on the left side, there are so many NoSQL databases. And also important for NoSQL databases is that there are different concepts. So there are graph databases, there are document-oriented databases, there are key-value stores, and all of these have different concepts. And nevertheless, all of them, of course, have to be integrated into your application area. And so the next important thing is that NoSQL is complementary to other concepts. So you can talk about NoSQL on the one side, but you can also talk about cloud and about big data, and these often are complementary. So you usually do not say you use NoSQL or you use big data, but usually they are complementary. I have just one example here. That's Amazon Web Services, the Simple Storage Service. So the Simple Storage Service, which I will also use later with the Camel to integrate it, It's NoSQL, it's a key value store. You store your large objects. It's also a cloud service, you store it in the cloud. And it's also big data, so you can store objects which are up to 5 terabytes. So that's really huge and big. And so you can see that all of these concepts are complementary in many use cases. So that's already all about NoSQL, just that we have the same understanding. And now let's talk shortly about Apache Camel. So when I talk about Apache Camel, I talk about integration frameworks. And this slide here is great to show the differences to some other concepts. So as I said in the beginning, some customers just use the API of a different database to integrate it. So when you use Amazon, you can use the Amazon Java API or the Ruby API and write a lot of glue code every time you integrate these databases into your application. On the other side, you can also use an integration framework, such as Apache Camel. This helps you a lot because it avoids you to write all this glue code. Apache Camel does this for you. And then there's also the Enterprise Service Bus, which has much more features. It has monitoring and it has business process management and many other features. So in this talk, I'm mainly talking really about integration frameworks. And there I'm talking about Apache Camel. So in the Java environments, there are different integration frameworks available. Besides Apache Camel, there's also Spring integration, which is part of the Spring framework. And you can also use Mule as an integration framework. I've chosen Apache Camel because, in my opinion, it's the best one in the Java environment. I will talk a little bit more about it in the next slides. And so if you want to read more about the comparison, you can look at my blog. You can get the slides later with the link to read more about the differences between, but definitely Apache Camel is the best integration framework on the Java platform. Okay, and what is Apache Camel? Apache Camel implements the enterprise integration patterns. Enterprise integration patterns are there to divide a huge integration problem into many smaller parts. These problems are there every time when you integrate different systems. So here are some examples of enterprise integration patterns. For example, you have a filter, right? You get messages and you have to filter it. Or you have a content-based router, where depending on the content of the message, you send it to different endpoints. Then you can use, for example, a splitter, which is another enterprise integration pattern. So you get a message with much content and you split it up to further process it. And these are patterns which are needed in many or in most integration projects. So if you split it up, it's much easier for you to realize. And Apache Camel implements these enterprise integration patterns. So each of these patterns is just a method call in the end, usually. So you don't have to write all of this glue code by yourself, but Apache Camel does it for you. You just have to call this method. And further advantage is that with these enterprise integration patterns, you can really model your integration problem in a standardized way. Here you can see one example, and even if you have never seen enterprise integration patterns before, as a developer, you definitely understand what is happening here, right? So in this case, I'm reading files from a directory, and then I transform the file, and then I split it up into several different parts of the message, and then depending on the content of the file, I send it to different endpoints. Usually, most large integration problems have these patterns inside. And so you can really model it easily. And with Camel, you can also realize it easily afterwards. Let's take a short look at the architecture of Apache Camel. Apache Camel, if you see on the left side, domain-specific language which Apache Camel uses. And here you can see one of the benefits, which I will show you in the demo later. No matter which technologies you have to integrate, so you can use JMS or HTTP, or in our case, many different NoSQL databases, the concepts are always the same. You have different consumers and producers which use endpoints and components, and no matter which component you want to use, the syntax for the code is always the same. And that's really the great thing about Camel. And all of this transformation, for example, from a JMS message to an XML file or whatever, this can be done automatically by Camel if the converter already exists. Or you can write, of course, your own converters. And so this is the architecture of the integration framework. Also, Spring integration and other frameworks have the same architecture in the end. The goal is to write a glue code for you, though, that you don't have to do it on your own. One of the real favorites also of Apache Camel compared to its competitors is that you can choose your favorite DSL. So usually people use the Java DSL or the XML DSL, but you can also use, for example, Scala or Groovy, or even a Kotlin DSL is in the work by James Strachan at the moment. So that's really cool. Some people, about 50%, use the Java and 50% the XML language. So it's your choice. Both have the same functionality, and it's just a matter of taste which one you use usually. And as I mentioned before, Apache Camel has many, many different components. I think about 120 at the moment. So you can really integrate all of your different technologies and products easily. And as we will see at the end of the session, you can also create your own components very easily. A further advantage is that you can deploy Apache Camel everywhere you want in the Java environment, on every JVM. You can use it standalone in a main method, in a Java class. You can also deploy to a web container like Tomcat or Jetty, to an application server like WebSphere or GlassFish or whatever. You can use it in combination with a Spring container. You can use it in the OSGI container, or you can deploy it in the cloud and combine that. So it's really flexible. You can use it everywhere in the JVM. That's a huge advantage of Camel. And maybe important to mention is, this is so easy because Camel is just a bunch of libraries, right? It's just some chars which you have to add to your project. And this is why you can combine it with every of these containers and deploy it everywhere. And what's also very important, of course, for an open source project is that it's enterprise ready. So Camel is over 5 years old now. It really scales good, supports all kinds of error handling and transactions. You can monitor it via JMX and other toolings like Nagios or Hyperic or whatever you use for monitoring. And you also have a lot of tooling, which some we will see later too. And of course, commercial support. So it's definitely enterprise ready. And regarding the community, Camel definitely rocks. So this is also compared to its competitors like Spring Integration. It has much more users, the mailing lists are bigger. You can see much more blogs and articles or talks at conferences and all of that stuff. So Apache Camel definitely has the largest community of all these integration frameworks. And now before I go on with the NoSQL databases, I just want to show you a very short demo that you get a feeling about how Apache Camel works. So let's get to the IDE. So here you can see one integration route. This is an extensive route builder. And here you write your integration routes. You always use a from endpoint. This is where your route starts. And you have one or more two endpoints where you send your messages to in the end. And as I mentioned before, no matter which technology you use, in this case, I read the data from a file, from a directory, and all files in this directory are processed. And I send it, in this case, just to files or to mocks. You can also use, again, JMS, or as we will see later, some NoSQL databases. All of that is the same syntax here. And in the middle, you can do your processing. Here you can use your enterprise integration patterns. For example, in this example here, I use the split enterprise integration pattern to split the CSV file up into several different parts of the message. And I use the content-based router. So depending on the content, when the content has, for example, in this example, a DVD, a string, then I send it to this directory or otherwise here, or if it doesn't contain a DVD or CD, you send it to a mock at the moment. So as you can see here, this DSL is really easy to read. Also, if you have never seen Camel before, you probably understand what's happening here. And all of this implementation logic for these enterprise integration patterns and for these transformations, for example, from a file to a mock or to a JMS endpoint is done implicitly by Apache Camel. And also, of course, the implementation of such patterns such as the splitter. Nevertheless, you can easily add your own custom logic. In this case, you can also use simple POCHOs, so just plain old Java objects if you want, like in this example, if you have existing POCHOs. Or you can use implement processors. These implement a Camel interface, so here you also can write your own custom logic. But the difference to the POCHOs is that you have access to the Camel exchange, Here you can get your message input and your errors and so on, so it's easier to get access to all of this content. So as you can see, you can easily add your own custom transformation logic to these camel routes. And also great about camel, you can also test it automatically. This is based on JUnit, camel test support. And here's just a simple test where I send a file to this endpoint. Remember, let's look in the root again. The consumer endpoint is a file. The directory is orders. And in the test, I just send via the template producer, which is part of the camel unit test library. You can send a file to this producer, to this endpoint, to start the testing the route. And you can also create a mock here. And finally, you do your assertions. So if you have used JUnit or any other testing framework before, then you can easily test your camel routes too. And here, what's also again important to mention is that, again here, if you want to send a JMS message, you just change this to JMS, and then you enter your queue instead of your directory, and that's it. And that's no matter which of these components you use in camel, it's always the same way, always for even for testing. So we can run this test too. So as you can see, it's just a unit test, and it runs, and no surprise here. Okay, that was just a really short introduction to camel. I hope now everybody who has not seen it before can now imagine how Apache camel works. Let's get back to the slides. Okay. So now we can look a little bit deeper into how to integrate these different databases. I will first start with a graph-oriented database. As you can know, probably the most well-known one is Neo4j at the moment, but there are different other ones. And Neo4j, for example, is a graph database that these databases use graphs instead of tables. And they are really powerful tools if you have graph-like queries. So the basic example is Facebook Friends, right? So when you look at the API, you just store your different endpoints and then the relation between these endpoints, between these connection points. And though the API is just for realizing graphs. And of course, as I said, NoSQL databases will not replace SQL databases. But in some use cases, it makes much more sense, and it makes it much easier to use such a NoSQL database. And this example, the graph database. And here again, the good news is if you use camel, it's always the same concept to integrate these databases. As you can see here for the Neo4j, there's the Neo4j component. And you use this component here instead of file or JMS, which I used before. And then you add the URL where your server started. And that's it, basically. So there are no surprises here. You just change the endpoints and the configuration for this NoSQL database, and then you can use it with camel. And so no matter where your data comes from and which integration patterns you want to use inside, it's always the same. I have a demo here too. Here's one of the important hints for starters. I was not aware of this before, so as it's open source, you all know it, Apache Camel, you can just check out the whole project. So that's really great to start, because all of these components have also unit tests. And when you want to use a new component with Camel, which you haven't used before, the first thing to do is just simply to look at the unit tests, because then you can easily see how they work. And this is what I did here too. So let's look at just one test. And here you can see, let's go up a little bit. There are different concepts which are available here, but in the end, you define here your direct, your start point, and your Neo4j endpoint. So you see here is your endpoint, and then you create your route to test it. So in this test case, you create your route implicitly in the test case, but of course you can, as I did in IntelliJ, you can of course also develop just your routes and then test it from other classes. You don't have to create the routes inside a test class. That's of course also important to know. And so what's happening here, as you can see, you have your root. And in this test case, there's also some assertions within the root, though that's of course nothing you would do in production. But here for testing it, you can also do tests within the root. And that's it. As you can see here, again, we use the producer template to send some messages to this test here, to this root. And in this case, we are sending 100 messages to the root. And the root from the direct start point, direct is another component which is just a synchronous call. So when you send a message to a direct endpoint in Camel, it just calls the next endpoint. And here it is the Neo4j endpoint. And so if we run this test, we will create 100 nodes. And then you can see that and this unit test works, and we have created 100 nodes. I can run this test too here. Let's run the test which creates nodes and relationships. Oops. Okay. Well, it should not download anything. I did it some minutes before. I hope it will finish in a second. Yes. Okay, and as you can see, it's just another unit test. And now when we look at the Neo4j web interface, we can refresh here. And there you can see that you should see exactly. You can see here that we have created new nodes and new relations. You can also use this a little bit strange query language of Neo4j. I'm not aware really how it is working. Okay, so let's skip that. But as you can could see here, I created some new nodes and some new relations, so the unit test worked. And that's basically the way you integrate NoSQL databases with Camel. So if you know Camel, there's really no surprise here when you see that you just have to use other endpoints and configure it a little bit other, but in the end it's always the same. So that's the most important news of this talk probably. Nevertheless, I will show you some of the other ones. For example, if you use, I will also show you other tooling, how you can solve the problems. If you use look at key value databases, for example, I've mentioned before Amazon Web Services, Simple Storage Service is one of them, or there's React and some others. So the Simple Storage Service is a part of the Amazon Web Services part. And you can really store very large objects there, up to 5 terabytes. So that's really huge objects. And you can use REST APIs or SOAP API or Java API. So there, again, you would have a lot of glue code for this. As you can see here, you have to write this all the time. Or again, with Camel, you just have to add this component to your library stack. And then you just send a message from somewhere to the AWS S3 endpoint, and you say where you want to store your bucket. And this is the producer example. And of course, you can also consume messages, then use it in the from endpoint. As you can see here, you can also read data from Amazon. So as you can see here, once again, with Camel, no matter which of these technologies you use, it's always the same concept. I say it several times here, but that's the real great benefit of Apache Camel. I also want to show you some other tooling above, on top of that. So until now, you have seen just writing the code in the IDE by yourself. There's also tooling on top of that with the Talon ESP. The great thing about the Talon ESP is that it's also just an open source ESP, which is also based on several different Apache projects. So the IDE is based on Eclipse, and the runtime, as you can see here, is based on Apache CXF, Apache Camel, Apache Keras as OSGI container. So it's really based up on the de facto standards for these problems and frameworks. And you see it here, it's just a slide for reference, but I will show you a demo now, how this works. So as you can see here, it's a little bit small. I have a bad solution, but I will hope it works nevertheless. As you can see, it's just based on Eclipse. And Talon is a code generator, so you don't have to write the code on your own to write the routes. You just drag and drop from the right side some components and drag it in the middle, and then you have to configure your components. For example, if you see again the file component, you just have to write your file endpoint, your URL of the directory. In this case, I have used a property file for it. And you can use your splitter, how to split it, or how to filter it. In this case, you can use all of the camel features, so you can use the camel simple expression language, or you can use Groovy or XPath or whatever you want. Though, again, that's just tooling on top of TAML, so under the hood there's camel, and you can use all of the camel features. But the code is generated, and it's much more efficient to create your routes. And you can also run it directly in the studio, of course. And also the great thing here is that you can see some live debugging. So it's very easy to follow what's happening in your route. For example, in this case, I have 6 files in this directory. I filter it just to process one file. This file has 228 message parts. These are logged and then routed. In this case, I send test messages to a processor and all other ones to a log. Of course, in practice, you would use here a JMS endpoint or a CXF web service or whatever else. And so as you, I just wanted to show here you how the tooling works. And here I have also implemented one example with Amazon Web Services. So this is again the same. I read a file from the directory. And then in the end, I just have to enter my URL here for my Amazon account. And that's it. You drag and drop your components from the right. Then you run it. And let's wait until it's done. Okay, it's done. And now if we can look at the Amazon management console to the simple storage part. Internet is a little bit slow, unfortunately. Let's wait 2 more seconds. Okay, now it's loading. So as you can see here, this is the web user face of Amazon. And here you can see your buckets, which are created. And the newest bucket, which I just have created via Camel, is the bucket for ApacheCon. Why this one? Because my endpoint, the Amazon endpoint has to configure the bucket. And so this is the bucket which is created. And here's my file, which I have read from my consumer endpoint. And usually in practice, of course, you process it with enterprise integration patterns and some other components in the middle. And in the end, here I stored it with Amazon. So as you can see, it's really easy to realize all of that. There's also one alternative to using these components for Amazon, for example, in Camel. So these are generic APIs. So for example, like JClouds or Delta Cloud or Sharpbox for .NET. In this example, I have JClouds, an example. What is JClouds? It's a generic API for IaaS, so for cloud services which have a compute API and a blob store. So blob store in this case is a key value store, so no SQL store like Amazon S3. And the cool thing about these generic APIs is that they support several different vendors, but you can use one code for all of them. As I will show you here, here's the glue code when you write it on your own without Camel. Then you write all that code. But nevertheless, no matter which provider you want to use, if it's Amazon or Asia or whatever is supported, you still have just to switch this one line here. So that's a great part about these generic APIs such as JClouds. And also the good news is that there's also a Camel component for JClouds. So you can also use JClouds in your integration routes. And here it's the same, you use the JClouds component, and then you just have to switch from Amazon, for example, to Azure. And that's it. So it's very easy to use, and this is a benefit if you want to use different cloud key value stores in one application. Maybe you want to store it in different ones for security reasons or whatever. Then you should use a generic API like JClouds with Camel. Okay, the next part in memory database. I will just talk very shortly about the next three ones because, as you have seen already, it's always almost the same concepts. I don't want to bore you. For in-memory databases, I have an example with Hazelcast, which is, as the name says, an in-memory data grid. The cool thing here is that this is some peer-to-peer concept where you store your data in memory, but nevertheless it's distributed to several different nodes. So as you can see here in the glue code example, you code your write with Hazelcast almost the same way as you use the collection API in Java. So when you can use it with queues, you can use it with maps and some other things. And it's almost the same way to code, but it is distributed over several nodes. And here again, the example with Hazelcast. In this case, I used the Hazelcast root with a queue. You can also use a map here or whatever else is supported by Hazelcast. And in this case, I produce something, I send it to Hazelcast, and then via consumer, I can also read it again from Hazelcast. I also have a demo here. I've realized it also with the Talon ESB, just to show it to you in some seconds here. Again, it's the same. In this example, I use a timer component to send messages every second, and these messages are sent to the Hazelcast producer. Here you see the URL. And then there's also a Hazelcast consumer, which then reads these messages and just logs it. So of course, here in the session, I always show very simple demos because it's just about how to integrate these technologies. In practice, these routes would be much more complex. When I'm at customers, of course, the routes are much bigger and do much more integration logic. But for trying it out, it's very good to use these simple examples. And as you can see here, every message which is sent to Hazelcast producer is also consumed. Of course, you can also realize it with several different VMs because, as I said, it's a distributed peer-to-peer system. Okay, so the next one, document-oriented databases. Probably the most important ones are MongoDB and CouchDB, especially in the Java environment. In this case, I have used MongoDB, but there's also a component for CouchDB available in Camel. And document-oriented databases, if you have not used them before, they store the data structured in JSON files or XML files, but it's much more flexible concept than SQL. So if you want to add some new information, you can just add a new column or what, and it's much easier to process it and change it than with SQL databases. And that's the main use case where you use it. In this case, I have an example found by Disney. They have several different online games and persist their state information in such a document-oriented database because the statuses often change. There are new attributes which have to be added to some of these online saves. And that's much easier with a document-oriented database than with a SQL database. So again, here's the glue code. It's very easy to use this glue code all the time, but it's a lot to code. And so here again is the Camel example. No surprise here, you use the MongoDB component. You say what database you use and what you want to do with it. The same for the consumer. I have also one example here. Here I have again on the console, just a unit test. So these are really great, as I said, for learning these new components. You just look at the components from the source code from the subversion repository of the Apache Camel project. And in this case, I have several different routes where I send some request to MongoDB to find something. So here you can see there are several different routes in one root builder class, so you can also combine several roots into one class, of course. That's very flexible. In Camel, you can also, of course, configure when to start which root. So, for example, firstly start root 1 and then root 2 or whatever. And then you have your tests. It's again always the same concept. You use the template producer to send a message. You can also get responses back, like here with the request body. And then you use an assertion and check out if the assertion was true. And yeah, it's pretty similar to the other examples, so don't want you to waste your time with that anymore. Though this was another example of a document-oriented database. Just one last word about column-oriented databases, such as HBase or Cassandra, Google Bigtable. These are used if you want to access several columns of the data. So for example, in these examples I've used, for example, CRMs or data warehouses, when you have queries where you just want a column of all customers with a SQL database, it's very cost effective to do it and takes a long time. With these column-oriented databases, it's much faster. And here again, it's the same example. I have first the code, and then in this case, I have used the Camel Spring XML DSL. So to show you that how this looks, in the past, I have used the Java DSL because it's also the one I prefer. I like it much more. But several people also use the XML DSL of Camel. It's just a matter of choice, of taste. Both work the same, have almost the same functionality. So I have not set up a HBase on my MacBook Air, to be honest, so I don't have the demo here right now, but it would be the same as all. I think what's much more interesting now at the end, after you have seen that all of these databases can be integrated in the same ways, it's really easy to do it. There's sometimes a problem when there is no component for Camel, right? Camel until now has about 120 components, but you can easily create your own components too, and this is what I want to show you that might be a little bit more interesting now. So how do you create your own components in Camel? You just can start with a Maven archetype, which creates a skeleton for you. And then you have just to implement your business logic here. You have to implement just four classes. It's a component, it's an endpoint, and the consumer and the producer, if you want both. And instead of talking a lot about theory, I will show this to you in action too, how I created a Salesforce component. And so I will switch to the IDE again. Okay, and in this example I've created a Salesforce component. So when you start with your Maven archetype, it just generates a skeleton for you. It's just these classes, and you have just to add, and it also creates the unit tests for it, and you have just to add your business logic. So I will start with the component, just take a little look. In the component class, you define how your URI should look like. In this case, I use Salesforce, like the other one was JMS or MongoDB or whatever. And then you have also to define what's happening with the stuff which you enter in your routes and how you process it. So it's just a little bit of code here, as you can see. And there's also the endpoint. In the endpoint, this is a class which is then inherited from the producer and the consumer. In this class, you do, for example, stuff like implementing your connection. Because when you use the component to Salesforce, you have to use a connection to Salesforce. And in this case, this is how these components are implemented. In this case, I use the Salesforce API. And what I've shown before so often was this glue code for Amazon and MongoDB and so on. With Camel here, you just write it once in this endpoint class, and then you can use it in your endpoints when you use them in your routes. As you can see here, I use this is a Salesforce API where I do the connection. And then I also implement a producer and a consumer, which, for example, in this case, the producer really stores data in the Salesforce application in the cloud. The same for the consumer. It reads from the Salesforce cloud, and here tests also implemented. So as you can see here, it's again the same. So as example here, I again use a direct component to start, and then I send something to Salesforce. In this case, it's a string, and I use again the template producer and send it to Salesforce to test this component. And we can run this test here. Should also be green. After some seconds, I hope the internet connection works still. Yes, it is green and worked. And now if we take a look at the Salesforce web application, so Salesforce is a CRM, a cloud service, and this is just a development version, but the real production version looks almost the same. And I have created my custom object, which is an article. This is an object in the Salesforce API, and you also have to use the Salesforce query language, which is almost the same as the SQL query language. I don't know why they didn't use the SQL, but you have to use the Salesforce query language. And here's, then you can see the articles, which this is a custom object which I created. And if we now go to view all, we should see the object I created just now. And it's 10.5.3, so that's the object I just created with Camel. So you can see also this worked easily. Okay, though, that was an example of how to create a custom component with Apache Camel. Of course, there are also different alternatives. So if you just have to use an API once, so if you have just one use case where you want to connect to Salesforce, for example, in one case, then you probably will not write your own component. Then you also can, of course, use the SOAP or REST APIs of this provider. And of course, Camel also has very good integration to web services. That Dan will later do a talk with Camel and web services, which might be interesting for you. In this case, it's just one example. This is the same business logic which I implemented with the Camel component before, which I created for Salesforce. In this case, I just use the HTTP component of Camel and store it via REST. And it's very easy to solve. And this might be an alternative if you don't want to create your own component. Okay. Just one thing at the end. SQL, of course, is still very alive, of course. So today we have talked about the left side, about a lot of NoSQL databases and how to integrate them. Of course, with Apache Camel, you can also integrate all of your SQL stuff. And you will probably have to do it in the future, too, to work a lot with SQL. And there are Camel components, like the SQL component, the JDBC component. You have a JPA component. You can use MyBatis or Hibernate, so several different components which you can use. And I don't have an example here, but the concept is the same as with NoSQL databases, of course, so it's very easy to integrate all of them into your applications. And so that was it about my talk. I hope you did get the key message. Let's just recap that. NoSQL probably cannot be avoided. In several use cases, it's a much better solution than a SQL database. So it should be integrated, and as you have seen today, the integration is already possible, and Apache Camel really helps a lot to solve the integration of NoSQL databases without a lot of glue code, and you even can automatically test it. So I think Apache Camel is really the perfect tool if you have to integrate a lot of different technologies and products, and I hope you think so too. And that was it for my talk, and now I'm open to questions.
So if you get your NoSQL data store online and your target, if you've got a really spiky data flow where you got surges and peaks and valleys, can you use Camel to smooth out your data flow so you're writing your data store more consistently? Is there any mechanism in that for governing or throttling your data flow?
Yeah, the question was, does Camel also support if there are a lot of data sets and can you throttle it and fill that out and that stuff? That's exactly the idea behind Camel. What I showed today was about the NoSQL components, right? So, of course, that's only one part of Camel is the components, which I showed today. The other part is all this integration pattern stuff, and that's exactly that. There's a pattern for splitting, for throttling, for filtering and all that. So that's very important to know. That's the other part of Camel, which I did not show today. But of course, you combine both in one thing to use your integration.
then does CAML have the ability to aggregate, like you have a message that queries a bunch of data stores and databases, mm-hmm. with a, and also contains a fingerprint related to the message that made the individual query, responses from the database. You have the ability to take the fingerprint over a period of time and aggregate the responses back into a single response message back to the requester.
Yeah. Okay, the question was, just to keep it short for the video, can you aggregate messages from different databases and depending on different fingerprints and whatever and aggregate it to one message and so? And the answer definitely is yes also. That's also just another enterprise integration pattern, which is the aggregator pattern. And so there are about 80 or 90 enterprise integration patterns. And all of these problems, as you mentioned this one and the other guy mentioned other problems, these problems occur in almost all integration problems. And that's why these patterns exist, and I can recommend this book to everyone. And that's just one of the implementations, that's the aggregation, and that's also possible with CAML, yes.
Okay. So. Another related one, okay. If you have, how well do you support event trigger, such as you have a message sender and a receiver, and have the receiver, when he receives the sender, once he puts a message in, say sends a message, he can trigger the receiver that a new message is available. Oh. Now you have a receiver that's consumed the message, send a trigger back to the sender of the message and says the message is being consumed.
Okay, so the question was about, in the end, about complex event processing. So how you do process events when receive messages and then do some other stuff. That's not implicitly implemented in CAML, I think, but there are, for example, there's an ESPA component and that stuff, so you can integrate your complex event processing engine into CAML, but it's not implicitly implemented in the CAML as far as I know. Yes.
So once we've got those components declared and built, how are we actually firing? Like when and where are we firing those off so that the actual processing happens?
I have shown the example in the IDE where I just used the unit test, but of course it depends on where to be deployed. For example, if you're deployed in a standalone application, the application runs and then all routes run. By default, the routes are started automatically, but you can define this when to start a route and when to stop it and just start a route when another route started or so. So you can configure all of that how you need it.
Okay.
Yeah?
So one of the things I was wondering about when we actually looked at the unit test and used the endpoint that was a file, it looked like basically the way that CAML's figuring out what content or what
Mm-hmm.
Is there a way that you can actually, or maybe a better question is how would you actually stub that out so if you actually don't want to bind to a processing location, you actually want to just send the content, how would you actually stub that out, or would you do it a different way?
You want what to do? I didn't understand that.
So I guess I'm asking, obviously if you're using a file system path, you're bound to a file system path, and you're looking to a specific location to get the content. I was just wondering how you would actually make that so you could have the root refer to a file system location, but stub it out so it actually is bound to that when you're running the test.
You mean just configuring another directory or that stuff? Or
Yeah. It's not even anything. You don't want to look actually at the file system, you just want to send the content, but you want the root to actually look when you're actually using the root. You want that to be file system location. How would you stub that out so you could test it without having that file there?
You can also use dummies or mocks or whatever for that, though that depends on the use case. So there are different solutions. So that depends on the use case. Sometimes you can also create a dummy file and send it there via the test case, and you can use properties with test and prod or whatever, though there are so many different alternatives here. Yeah?
What was the book that you told us to read about enterprise integration patterns?
That's just the title of the book. Okay, got you.
That's a book except by Gregor Hopi and Bobby Wolf. It's about 600 pages or so. But it's a de facto standard. There's also only really this one book. There's not 10 books or so. There's just one book, and that's the book everybody should read when you have to integrate different stuff, because it explains exactly these different problems which everybody asks. Does Camel support it? Splitter and filter and aggregator, and all of that is described in this book. The problem, the solution, the use cases, and so on. Okay, so thank you a lot. If you have more questions, contact me via email, Twitter, LinkedIn, or whatever. And thank you a lot.